Good afternoon. Thank you so much for coming this afternoon. My name is Anne Rose Kitagawa. I'm Chief Curator of Collections and Asian Art here at the Jordan Schnitzer Museum of Art. And it's my very great pleasure to speak to you today with the co-curator for this exhibition, Professor Akiko Walley from the History of Art and Architecture Department here at the University of Oregon. We are so elated to be able to present to you some of the background to our special exhibition on view upstairs, Expanding Frontiers, the Jack and Susy Wadsworth Collection of Postwar Japanese Prints. This is kind of the perfect show to encapsulate what we hope this museum does well, which is we are a teaching museum, and we want very badly to involve faculty and students at the University of Oregon in the organization of special exhibitions. And this is a wonderful case study of that, because we were fortunate enough to be able to acquire a remarkable, distinguished collection of 157 modern and contemporary Japanese prints representing 77 different artists. And because of this amazing windfall in 2012, we had the opportunity to branch out. Part of the reason the show is called Expanding Frontiers is that one is forgiven if one hears the words Japanese and prints together, if one thinks of the Edo period ukiyo-e tradition, the tradition in which we have many famous artists, Hokusai, Hiroshige, Utamaro among them, who were able to express amazing things about the Edo period urban culture. And those images of kabuki actors, of courtesans, and of landscapes and still lives are certainly something that are impressed on everyone's brain in terms of iconic images of world culture. But this exhibition is completely different. And we realized that when we were putting the show together, that this really was going to be an expansion in the sense of these are not Edo period prints, these are 20th century prints. These are not all woodblock prints. They represent woodblock, but many other techniques. And it allows us to expand not only what we represent in our galleries, but what we can teach to our students. So, within the 157 prints, there are intaglio prints, there are lithographs, there are screen prints, and there are mixed media prints that totally expand what we are able to present to our students. And it was especially nice to have the students themselves participate in the planning process. And so with that, I think I will hand the mic over to Professor Akiko Walley, who had done a lot of the grunt work of the teaching with the collection. So Professor Walley.
Hello, my name is Akiko Walley. I teach Japanese art history at the History of Art and Architecture Department. Thank you very much all for coming on this rainy day. There are two courses that I wanted to mention a little bit in that I offered in collaboration with many different people from different institutions in the university in preparation for this exhibition. The first one is Art History 399 Japanese Prints, and it was taught in fall of 2014. And this was experimental class that was made possible through the generous funding of Tom and Carol Williams Fund, which sponsors, experimental courses that engage students in, not just classroom reading activities, but something that is much more hands-on. And this class was exactly that. So the idea for this class was to survey Japanese prints through techniques. And so what we did was, the students had a session. Every session was in the museum, and they listened to my lecture part of the time, which was not the most important or interesting part. But they got to examine the works very, very closely. But what was special about this class was this. So the class was prepared in collaboration with the museum, but also the art department. And I collaborated with Mika Boyd and Charlene Liu, who teach print classes for the art department, to come up with five sessions for the students for this class to teach them how to make relief print, intaglio, lithography, and screen print. And the last session was mixed media. And so what you see here on top, this is the students producing their own relief print. and they were able to try out printing using traditional Japanese printing pad called baren, and also using printing press. And the one in the middle is them trying out lithography, which is something that is very, it's a very time-consuming, onerous process that not too many of the, even the art department students have the chance to engage. And at the bottom, students are working on screen printing. So these students, some of them are from art department, but many of them, this is the first time producing any sort of print. But Mika and Charlene prepared so well over the summer that even for the first timers, they were able to create works that were not just, you know, like experimental, but beautiful. And this is the relief prints that everybody made. And down here, you see the intaglio prints. They tried out etching, or actually dry point. And these are the screen print that they did. And this is the mixed media that combines here the lithography and the screen printing. So through this class, what we were able to do was to really feature technique. And we were able to do this class because the Wadsworth collection dovetailed the museum collection so well, which is very, very strong on woodblock print. But for other techniques, the museum collection did not have too much. But the Wadsworth collection had many representative pieces on intaglio, lithography, screen printing, but also mixed media. So, and how this class kind of translated into the exhibition is our focus on technique when we were thinking about how to organize the exhibition space. And with that, would you like to?
Sure. So actually, if we go back one slide, you see a schematic of our Barker Gallery for special exhibitions upstairs. And we have put an arrow at the space that we assumed would be the entrance for most people who walk into the museum, in the sense that when you walk in the front doors of the museum, you talk to the nice people in visitor services, and then you see, hopefully, there are television screens, monitors that have information about the show, which we hope helps you move over towards the right side when you're choosing between stairwells. The reason that we did this is that, as a curator, we were a little bit bossy. We wanted to have people have the opportunity to encounter the prints in a chronological order. And it was important because the Wadsworth collection covers the period that these collectors lived in Japan, but also incorporates some very important mid-20th century prints that we wanted people to see as the background for the show. So we actually put a wall there that makes you go in a certain direction, like you're a pinball and you're going through a machine. And we wanted very badly to invite people into the exhibition with an image that could represent the show, this wonderful image by Sonoyama Harumi, which looks like a photograph, but isn't. It was hand done. It was a lithograph. So he actually drew on the lithographic stone. You know, and multiple stones in order to achieve this amazing illusion of a photograph. But he became so annoyed with people assuming that he was just making photographic prints that he actually started insinuating discontinuities in the perspective to prove that, no, this is not a photograph. I did this by hand. So we wanted to have an image that was pointedly not a woodblock print to represent the show. And this was irresistible in the sense that it has printer's ink and insinuates something of technique and is playful and, you know, quite accomplished. So it seemed like the right way to start. But as you look at the space, those dark blocks at the bottom are entrances. So you can imagine from the curator's standpoint, there are challenges to a space that has multiple entrances. So again, we tried to make people go in a certain direction, but also to have it be satisfying whichever door you walked through. The show itself is organized, and I can't remember if the next slide starts showing, let's see. There we go. So what we wanted to do was set things up in such a way that there were certainly beautiful prints that one could encounter. Of the 157 prints in the collection, we could not fit everything, so we made choices with students to privilege 109 of them. I believe there are four more in our regular Japanese galleries. So it is not the full collection that is shown, but just a smattering to give you a taste of the wonders of this collection. However, we did want, because of the student involvement and the interest in techniques, to have some place where people could go to learn about those techniques. So actually, on the back wall of that temporary wall, there are four prints set up side by side with explanations of the different, very basic explanations of the different techniques of relief, intaglio, lithography, and screen printing. And as we keep moving forward, there is an entire gallery devoted to, not a very Japanese-sounding name, Gaston Petit. Gaston Petit was a French, or is a French-Canadian friar of the Dominican Order who moved to Japan in the early 1960s after studying printmaking as in Canada and ended up setting up a print shop in which artists could go to either have prints produced by Petit to their directions or learn from Petit how to produce their own prints. So he was helping artists to branch out into the relatively rarer forms of lithography and screen printing. So this is a room that is devoted to Petit's works, there are two of which on the far wall of that gallery, surrounded by a number of the works by the artists who were in a constellation around him. As a printmaker himself, he actually became an author explaining about the techniques of modern and contemporary prints. And it's very interesting. The 20th century reception of prints is really predicated on the interest of Western collectors. And two of the earliest collectors are, interestingly, James Michener, the author, and Oliver Statler, the CEO of the Statler Hotel chain. Who lived in Japan during the occupation period, became fanatically interested in these prints and wrote books in English introducing these artists to a Western audience. Gaston Petit is the third leg of that tripod, and because he himself was a printmaker, his real interest was in technique, and so he really delved into techniques, in part because he was there making prints with a lot of these artists, but he also wrote, he wrote two important books, one of them specifically about techniques, and he sought out the artists and asked them for works that they thought were the best example of their technique, and then exhaustively explained what the techniques were that to create those prints. What makes Gaston Petit important in the context of this show is that the Wadsworths found out that he still had 100 of his finest prints from these various artists. And they were able, in one fell swoop, to collect these works directly from Gaston Petit. That means that when you look at Gaston Petit's books and you see illustrations of these prints, we have the actual editions of those prints that were described in those books. So this makes this a really rich teaching collection. As you move forward through the exhibition, we wanted to forefront other things. So we have some walls devoted to specific artists. As curators, we constantly worry about how to organize an exhibition such that it will be enticing to the viewer, how to draw people into the space. So we spent a lot of time in the spring talking with students about vista walls. As you walk into the exhibition, what is it that is this magnet that is going to draw the viewer in? And we spent a lot of time discussing this, and I know that Akiko will talk next about the exhibitions course that we did, but students did original research on a lot of objects, and we wanted to forefront that in the exhibition. So the original research that students did is not only published in the catalog with their names, but you'll see their names on the labels. And we tried to sprinkle the works that they studied throughout the exhibition. Likewise, there is an iPad monitor with a step-by-step recreation of the printing process of the Saito Kiyoshi print Maiko that you now see on the opposite side of that temporary wall from where the the techniques explanations are. And that, again, was a process that was exhaustively studied by one of our students who obsessively looked to see which ink was on top of which other ink on that print. So, you know, we were so glad that we could incorporate lots of different research that students had done. Likewise, from the curatorial standpoint, there are some prints that are quite large and some that are very petite and really require close, intimate scrutiny. And for that reason, we set up a smaller space that we are calling an alcove, for lack of a better word, in which some of those more delicate pieces, either physically small or delicate enough or with embossing, intaglio, aquatint that really kind of benefited from being seen in a quieter, smaller space. And last but not least, we had a double-sided display of one of the prints that we will no doubt talk about a great deal upstairs.
So as you can see from, you know, the way that we organized the show, technique and production process was something that was very important for us. And that sort of sprung out from the fall 2014 class. And not to publicize, well, it is kind of publicity. The catalog, as you can see, has the same Sonoyama piece on the cover, on the front. And the catalog is organized, for the most part, by four major techniques, plus the mixed media. So here too, we are featuring the different kinds of technique. And also we have two essays that one of them really talks about this early 20th century new movement in Japan called the Sōsaku Hanga, or the creative print movement, that the artists, kind of rebelling against the early modern printmaking tradition of artisanal workshop set up, and they claimed themselves to be the artists. And for them, doing their own process themselves was very important. And that is the chronologically the beginning portion of our show. And also there is another mini essay about intaglio lithography and screen printing in Japan, which are not the techniques that people think immediately when they hear Japanese prints, but they had their own history in Japan and turned out to be very, very important. So that's one organization that we used for the show. And with that,
We also have the very great pleasure of being able to invite the artist Hamanishi Katsunori to come and visit with us. So if your schedule is open on Wednesday evening at 5:30 p.m., you have the opportunity to come and hear a major global master of mezzotint come and speak about his work. We have three examples of Hamanishi's work upstairs, representing, I believe, from 1971, from left to right, 1971, 1979, and 1986 or 7, going from black and white through, although it's not quite visible, the central print actually has red underprinting the background that kind of changes the figure-ground relationship. And of course, the print on the right has this deep, lovely, teal-colored woodblock enhanced color on the mezzotint. Mezzotint is an intaglio technique in which the artist uses a tool called a rocker to roughen the surface of the metal plate, creating lots of little crevices to collect ink and create those beautiful velvety blacks, and then uses a burnishing tool to burnish down to have the lighter areas. It is not a fast technique. It is an incredibly methodical, meticulous technique, and as we've suggested, Hamanishi is a master of this technique, so we are very excited to be able to bring him here to speak to audiences about his work. So, because Akiko will not promote herself, I will talk a little bit about her amazing teaching. The students who studied in the classes with Professor Walley had the opportunity to look at these prints in a way that will actually be kind of difficult for students here to do in the future, because the prints arrived here unmatted and unframed. So we had naked prints that people could look at the front, they could look at the back, they could look at them with transmitted light. They could become really intimate with these prints in a way that you just can't quite do when they're in mats and frames in the gallery. And you know, that intimacy bred real enthusiasm. And I think that enthusiasm was enhanced by the opportunity to study them in the classroom, to study prints in the galleries, and to have very distinguished visitors come and speak to us, or we went to other places. So can see Professor Walley sitting in the gallery with the students surrounding her as we talk about Kusama Yayoi prints on the far wall. And I can't quite see what we're doing at the other end.
So the other end, this is actually Anne Rose right here leading the discussion. Yeah, so this class, the 4-500 level art history 488-588 Japanese contemporary print. And this is an upper level seminar that we have in our university where the undergraduate students are in the same classroom as the graduate students. So it's a combined class. And it is one of the highest level of class. And what Rose and I taught this class, and what we really wanted to do was to not only teach students about contemporary Japanese print, but, oh, it says Japanese art, but it's basically print. To make it so that it was more of a museum studies class. So we took turn here leading the discussion, and as Rose mentioned, we invited guests from the JSMA staff, as well as from outside, to come and speak about exhibition and collecting and gallery presentation. Here, what you see, this is Jody Sisenwang, the curator of Western art, talking to students about the Under Pressure show. And you know, so that students have the opportunity to hear the backstory of how the presentation, you know, the certain elements of presentation were chosen for this exhibition. And we also invited Marybeth Grable from Portland Art Museum to come and talk about her major print show that she did in 2012? Yes, 2012. But we also invited local collectors. For instance, this is Dr. Lee, sorry, was that me that I did that? Sorry. Dr. Lee Michaels and Mary Jean Michaels coming and bringing their wonderful collection of Japanese woodblock print, and you know, discussing with students, showing the prints about what you know they're collecting and experience, and some anecdotes. It was a wonderful session, and we also took a trip to Portland to go to Portland Art Museum to see the Breaking Boundaries show that Marybeth Grable organized. It was a wonderful show. So the idea behind this class was to kind of throw students off the deep end. So instead of assigning weekly readings, what we assigned was weekly research project. And students were not spoon-fed the readings that they needed to do for class, but they had the assignment to research certain artists. And we kind of try to make students take baby steps, so starting with the artist biography, but moving on to, for instance, collecting information to write collector's biography, and towards the end, proposing, coming up with a proposal for this Wadsworth exhibition. So this is the last session that we had, where students were divided into two groups and using the table as the Barker Gallery to try to organize the prints in their dream exhibition. And many of the ideas that they came up are reflected in the exhibition space upstairs. And the final research project were researching on the artists that are featured in the exhibition. But also, for instance, this is the content of the iPad, the relief printing process. So this is a student process, as Anne Rose mentioned, that presented step-by-step recreation of the process of making Michael. And you know, if you go through this, you see that there is this multiple layers of black that Saito used to create this deep, deep, almost matte black, but also some of the small elements were added at the very end, which gave this wonderful accent. So this was one of the most creative projects that was done for this class. And the how that translates to the exhibition is that not only that many of the ideas that student had for the class are represented in the show, but we try to scatter the prints that students wrote their research paper on, so that as one walks through the gallery, you're reading the labels that students wrote and enjoying the prints that they researched, they did the original research for, and learning from the students' experience.
Likewise, we were fortunate to get funding through the Spencer Foundation to have students stay on as interns. So there are two student-led gallery tours. One of them has already happened. The next one happens this Saturday at 2 p.m. And that's an opportunity to have the students speak to you about their original research in front of the actual prints that they studied. I must say, it has been incredibly gratifying to watch the students. And you know, whether or not students decide to go on and become curators of Asian art, we feel like the critical tools that they have learned as part of this class will be useful whatever it is that they decide to go on and do. And I'm happy to say that we have fully infected them. They will never walk into any exhibition ever again without thinking, why did they use that wall color? What were they thinking with that font? What is the piece that is going to draw me in? And it was incredibly gratifying to watch them as we went through, for example, the Portland Art Museum exhibition. I must say, the Portland Art Museum has incredible collections and their curator is amazing. They gave her the most awful space ever in which to do this wonderful exhibition. And the students were able to pick that apart and understand the genius of what it was that she had done and understand probably why she made the decisions that she did to put what where. So it was incredibly gratifying to watch the students evolve. So what you see here are the prints that students had initially done research on that you'll see reflected in the catalog, and now with the addition of the things that students have subsequently researched that they will be talking about on Saturday. You know, in some ways Akiko was talking about throwing students off the deep end. I felt like it was a really easy assignment. All they had to do was learn enough about the history of Japanese prints and about exhibitions to help us design an exhibition of Japanese prints. And they succeeded. So I feel like everybody won. So with that, if there are any questions, we're happy to answer here. Otherwise, we can proceed upstairs.
How do you want to do this?
In fact, they were part of a collaborative scheme in which a publisher commissioned the designer to produce the design, gave that design to professional block cutters who cut the blocks, who then passed those blocks on to professional printers who printed the prints. And that collaboration, that workshop, factory-like management, allowed for that incredibly high standard of printing. And you know, it's so easy for us in this day and age when we're bombarded with perfect photographic imagery to lose sight of the fact that it's kind of a miracle to be able to print in multiple colors, because you have to get all those colors aligned. If your registration is off, I think people here might still read newspapers. You know, in the Sunday funnies, when the color is off a little bit and the red of the lips is off to one side and it gives you that kind of queasy feeling, that can happen every time you add another block to a woodblock print. And when you look at traditional Japanese woodblock prints, you don't see a lot of mistakes like that. You see some, but not many. And that's because they are just so professional at what they do. So in the early part of the 20th century, you have a group of artists that are called collectively Sōsaku Manga printmakers, or creative printmakers, who are modeling themselves not on that traditional Japanese scheme, but looking towards Western painters, printmakers, people who they saw as individuals who were in control of the entire process. So they decided that for their art, they wanted to not only design it, but they wanted to cut their own blocks and print their own prints. And that is part of the reason that you see such a diversity in the expression on the walls here, because each of those are the singular expression of an individual artist who very pointedly wanted to be in control of the process. So we wanted to start with this because this, for Japan, is an important step. The other little bit of background that's useful to know is that the Edo period prints that not only we loved, but the Impressionists and Van Gogh and everyone loved, have class associations in Japan. They were associated with urban merchants who, within the value scheme at the time, were seen as bottom feeders, parasites on society because they didn't produce anything, but they actually subsisted and benefited from the production of others. So within Japan, printmaking as a technique actually had a relatively low status. So for these artists to choose to make prints wasn't choosing something that was high status. They would be appreciated as artists, but they were doing it because they were artists and they were impelled to do so. But as I think Professor Walley can help to explain, there is a sort of topsy-turvy thing that happens when all of a sudden Western people like Jones Michener, Oliver Stadler, Gaston Petit, and the juries at a lot of these biennales all of a sudden decide that this is the quintessential art form that Japanese people produce. And that rocked the art world in Japan, because all of a sudden all of these Western-style oil painters from Japan who had studiously provided their oil paintings, or sculptors who provided their sculptures to the biennales, were not winning prizes. It was the wood block printmakers who were winning the prizes. So I don't know what he
says. So one thing to point out, you know, this similar to what he does is to create prints about the ink that he uses to create his own prints. So it is wonderfully self-referential, and it's such a celebration of printmaking. So without it, it's very appropriate for that reason as well. And also, if you get close to it, you almost feel this feeling. And that is something that we both try to express to students. Because of this digital age and everybody's learning about Japanese or any art history through cardboard slides, that students are getting harder and harder to convince students that they actually need to come to the museum to look at these pieces on their own. And you know, so we are really trying to make students come into the gallery for any opportunities that they can get. So that's why studying from the original work for these classes was very, very important. And jumping off from what Rose mentioned about these print artists.
Should I take the catalog? I'm sorry. Sorry.
Hi. Hello again. So this scandalous happening of the print artist receiving high acclaims in biennales is something that we can see, for instance, in the work of Saito Kiyoshi here. He was one of the earliest post-war artists to receive high international acclaim above and beyond artists who are creating Western painting, as well as artists who are creating Japanese-style paintings at that time, who were not at all recognized by the international community because everybody thought the Japanese painting looked like sketches. So, and what is interesting about Saito, and here's the Maiko piece that I mentioned, is that he started off as a Western art oil painter, and then he didn't really like woodblock print at all. He thought that early modern Japanese woodblock prints are, you know, like, you know, he poo-pooed it, basically. He thought that they were, you know, nothing. But then he rediscovers them through his idols of Western painters like Kandinsky, Gauguin. And he, in the end, chooses wood as his material to produce his works. So many of these early creative print movement artists, they are predominantly working using wood, so relief print. But many of them actually were highly trained Western oil painting artists, or artists who actually worked on lithography or intaglio. But in the end, they came to choose wood as their primary material. And that was because of the wood's association to the earlier tradition of Japan and Japanese print. And with that, perhaps we can kind of move that away generally.
So on this side of the same wall, we have the techniques wall that we were discussing, in which you have another Saito print representing relief printing. You have an Araki Shinko print representing intaglio printing. I have a Wako print representing lithography, and a Sugiura print representing screen printing. And there's a little diagram beneath that is supposed to insinuate the process and the fact that three of these techniques produce a mirror image, whereas one of them actually produces an image that is oriented in the same direction. One of the joys for us about this show is, for printmakers, this is a gift, because the techniques in this show are so exquisitely produced that it's actually very difficult when you look at some of these prints to discern what the technique is. And Professor Walley has very pointedly had students come in and cover the labels and try and figure out what techniques there are being used, which I think is a wonderful exercise, because we tend to be quite siloed in the way that we approach art and think, well, relief printers do relief printing and intaglio printers do intaglio printing. But there is a lot of cross-fertilization. There are mixed media works, and there are works that completely confound your expectations. For example, there's a Hoshi Joichi print on the far wall there that, for all the world, I myself looked at it and assumed it was intaglio, because it has to be. How could you do that? It looks like an aquatint. It is actually woodblock. And these artists are looking at one another's work, catching inspiration, and doing new and interesting things. And I can't help but thinking some of them are just kind of showing off. And in some ways, why did he do it that way when he could have done that with aquatint? I think because he could. And I think that must have been extremely satisfying in some very basic ways. The far room here, if we just pop in for one moment, is the room devoted to Gaston Petit. And as you can see, there's a pair of prints on the far wall called He and She that are lithographs by Petit on the far wall. And as we suggested, they are surrounded by prints by many of the artists that Petit worked with or published about. And in some cases, this was a little bit difficult for us in the sense that so many of these artists are so terrific, and they not only represent the constellation of Petit, but they also represent themselves and other movements. And so there is a certain amount of a balancing act, just in the same way that when you put things in your home, you decide what you want to put next to one another. Some of these prints, it felt like Sophie's choice. Are we going to put this amazing Kitaoka Fumio print on this wall in the Petit room, or are we going to put it out there with the rest of the Sosaku Hanga artists, of which he was one of the important examples? But as we mentioned, Petit was a fascinating character, still lives and works in Japan. And actually, because of this show and the fact that we are forefronting him, he's just gotten in touch with us to say that he wants to give us more prints. So that is a wonderful example of how a show like this begets wonderful opportunities. Likewise, the Rick Bartow exhibition that had previously been in this space, Rick Bartow collaborates with Japanese printmakers, one in particular, Hiroshima Seiichi, who is himself an amazing mezzotint artist and has given Bartow many of his own prints, which Bartow is now giving to us. So we went from having zero mezzotints in our collection to a portfolio that we collected before the Wadsworth collection came to us, to more mezzotints with the Wadsworth collection, and now 23 more. So we are going to be Japanese mezzotint central soon. But we are so pleased that this kind of project begets further acquisitions. So with that, why don't we head out into the other space? So I don't know who you would like to speak about. Should we go to Shinoda, or is there anyone?
So one of the interesting things there about this collection is that there is many different mini themes within the collection. So we can cut and dice the collection in many different ways to feature certain aspects of the history of Japanese printmaking. And one such theme is the way in which some artists engage with the Japan's past and the Japan's printmaking history. For instance, the artist Moriyoshi Toshi that you see here, the peddler A, but also the tea maid in the Gaston Petit room, he restored a printmaking technique called kappazuri, which is basically a type of screen printing that was done in Kyoto during the Edo period, but since then kind of, you know, lost. But he, through his interest in creating textiles, he revived this technique in printmaking. And there are other artists who engage with the motifs that hark back to this early modern Japanese printmaking tradition, but try to create them in a completely unique way, so that in a way they're referencing, but at the same time subverting.
So as we move through the space, you'll see some wonderful examples of prints that are monoprints, that are produced in multiples, but then enhanced in ways that make each one slightly unique. One of them is this exquisite print that is a stencil print. This is Kawada-kan. And when we were looking carefully at this print with students, we realized that much of the color that you see is stencil printed. But if you look very carefully and if you kind of move your head around, you realize that some of the silver has been enhanced with brushwork, which makes this a unique example, even though it is certainly similar to others from the same edition. Likewise, we have a wall here devoted to the very distinguished, now 102-year-old artist, Shinoda Toko. Shinoda is a fascinating artist. She was born in Manchuria. She is Japanese. She was a very distinguished calligraphic protege at a very early age, had one-woman shows, and eventually moved to New York for a short period in the 1950s, where she palled around with the abstract expressionists, who, you know, which makes me giggle, had discovered the expressive powers of brushstrokes, which I think they've known about in Asia for a couple millennia at least. But in any case, she went back to Japan, and she, you know, she was still a pure calligrapher when she went back to Japan, but she met a Western printmaker who taught her about lithography. And this turned out to be a perfect medium for her to create multiples, because she could work with this medium called touche on the lithographic stone to create the multiple part of the image, but then at the end, go over it and create calligraphic brushstrokes, which make each of the prints somewhat unique. So we have three wonderful examples of her work here, which are both modern, but perfumed by tradition, which is a really wonderful aspect of her particular work. I think so many of the things that you see in this earlier part of the exhibition play off of some of the aesthetics that we associate with Japan, a respect for materials, the way that you see wood grain that hasn't been obscured but has actually been used in a lot of these. Likewise, the wonderful effects that you see here that look like marble, or they're just, you know, gestural and visceral, and the materiality of these prints is very different than the wonderful earlier Edo period prints, where it's really only in the 19th century that you see wood grain that is used, for example, in the background of the sky in a Hiroshige landscape, where it seems to have been like, oh, that's an added beauty. But here it's really become an element. It's something that artists play with. And when you look at some of the art, the Kiyoshi Saito's, in which you have all these different textures playing off one another, you get the sense that artists were really enjoying playing with the different elements of the tradition. Mm-hmm. So as we move on into this space, you'll see a real distinction happening between the earlier artists and some of the next generation. Yeah.
So in Japan, intaglio was actually was imported to Japan in the 16th century with the arrival of Christianity. And lithography was known in Japan since the 19th century. But what we start to see as we move into the next generation artists is the advent of screen printing. And screen printing in Japan didn't become an artistic medium until 1960s. So that was the latest in which to, for latest technique in which to come into Japan. And if we, you know, look at the date, what these artists are doing and what they're experimenting with, they are contemporary to some of the artistic movements that was happening in the United States and Europe, like the pop art movement and op art. So by this time in the post-war period, people were completely tuned, you know, engaged with the international community. And speaking of materiality, Matsumoto Akira here, this is a 6-set of portfolio called the Decoration Album. And Matsumoto is the artist that you can kind of geek out, and this is the artist pick, because you know, we need to kind of look at them closer, because from far away they might appear as if almost, you know, kind of careless, haphazard, abstract motifs. But what he does to create these nonchalant-like look is this very meticulous overprinting. And he is a woodblock print artist, but he started off his career as being the print professional printer. So he is a master of this technique. And you can see, you know, in the way that he engages with the past. For instance, in this particular print called the Master Sharaku's Decoration. And Sharaku was kind of an enigmatic Edo period artist who only worked for 11 months between 1794 and 95. And you can see an example of his print here. But he produced this wonderfully almost shocking, very dynamic portraits of actors, kabuki actors, during his time. And there are, you know, questions as to he was actually popular during his time or not. But anyway, his works became something that almost quintessentially Japanese early modern woodblock print. And what Matsumoto Akira is doing here is to use this portrait that Sharaku created as the starting point and take it apart and use bits and pieces. For instance, the very signature eye makeup that an actor has, and this closing of the eye that shows this dramatic moment and facial expression against this white-ish color of the paper to indicate this actor's face. And you see the hilt of the sword, and one part of it is a little bit missing. And that's because in the original, the actor was holding onto the tip of the hilt. And then these small emblems that resembles the emblems of the actors' houses that are kind of buried in this whitish silver background, which references the original mica background that was shimmering. But he uses this completely new pigment that would not have been available in the Edo period. And he buries all of that into this new pigment. So it's almost like a conversation with the past, and certain elements of the past is sinking into the present. But, you know, but still they are projecting its presence, so to speak, through these curtain of the pigment that indicates the presence. So it's a wonderful, wonderful piece.
So we had talked about artists who are interested in doing every aspect of the work themselves, but we've turned a corner and now we're at a place where artists feel that their achievement is the creation of the print. Does this sound like the Edo period again? And they're totally fine with the idea of having other professional printers print their work. So on this wall, and I feel guilty talking about this because I feel like this is kind of Akiko's topic. This is a wall devoted to the contemporary cutting-edge artist Kusama Yayoi, probably one of the most successful artists living and working today. Kusama is a fascinating character. She fulfills a lot of our fantasies about the gifted but perhaps troubled artist. She, at a very early stage, manifested a mental illness, which she has managed to commodify into an incredible career. She felt as though she was being completely consumed by patterns. She said even as a child, she would look at the pattern of wallpaper or the pattern of a tablecloth and felt like it was coming from the tablecloth or the wall and covering her, and she was going to be consumed. And she started producing obsessive works in which patterns reign, in covering, you know, canvases of this size with tiny little dots. And in some ways, printmaking, although she's not primarily known as a printmaker, is the perfect medium for her because it is something that reproduces. And here you can see examples of her work in which pattern is everywhere. And certainly her signature pumpkins. If you are lucky enough to travel around to a lot of major art museums, you will see not only two-dimensional pumpkins, but three-dimensional pumpkins. And I've even been to an island in Japan where you can go inside of one of her pumpkins. But the polka dots, the patterns that actually define forms are one of the things for which she is most famous. She came to the United States as a young woman, very frustrated with the Japanese art scene, participated and started all sorts of happenings in New York, sort of mock orgies and naked people walking across the Brooklyn Bridge, or riding a horse that was covered with polka dots in a polka dotted dress, or being in rooms that were completely polka dotted. And eventually she moved back to Japan, where she had absolutely no notoriety, and suffered a crisis and put herself into a mental institution where she still very happily lives today, but she is a major art mogul and controls an incredible queendom of art and produces some of the most valuable and wonderful works of art out there. Our Masterworks on Loan program has been very fortunate to borrow some really remarkable Kusama paintings. Kusama paintings are beyond our scope. We cannot afford to buy things like that. So a windfall of five Kusama prints like this, or the amazing Kusama intaglio print that Charles Froelich just gave us after the Rick Bartow show that you'll see in our Japanese galleries, are wonderful teaching opportunities for us.
So as we move towards the northern end of the gallery, so this is the quote unquote alcove space that we mentioned during the talk downstairs. And you will see, for instance, another reference to Sharaku in this old Chimakoto print. And this, again, is another print that you really have to get close to appreciate, because he has this wonderfully sensitive embossing that is done on the print that gets completely lost in the, you know, photographic reproduction. But what he does here is something slightly different from what Matsumoto was doing, although he is referencing the same artist. He is creating this image that is very identifiably Japanese, very identifiably early modern Japanese woodblock print, but using intaglio, and to create this wonderfully gradationed matte color, he used paper plate rather than woodblock. So he, although he's referencing the past, he is using the technique that is completely new in order to avoid wood. And as I mentioned, wood becomes one of the most important material for the immediate, you know, early 20th century and immediate post-war artists. So to not use wood becomes a statement in this work.
As you walk back out towards this wall, you might think about the curatorial dilemma of having these works, all of which are so bright and frenetic that they all just seem like the kids that run with scissors. And we tried very hard to figure out how can we possibly put these, and we decided, well, let's put them all together on a single wall. And actually, it was greatly helped by our prep crew. We don't want to pretend like it was just Akiko and myself and a group of students. There is a mass of people. It takes a village in a museum, and a lot of that village is below decks. But we think of ourselves often as the writers at the Spanish Writing School in Vienna. And if we do our jobs well, all you see is the horse. And in this case, the prep crew very wisely decided that, because we usually hang things with a center line so that everything is centered on that line. But when we did so with this wall initially, before the exhibition opened to the public, it was still really frenetic. And our prep crew, the head of prep, Joey Capodona, said, why don't we top line them? why don't we line everything along the top? And somehow that gave a level of stasis to this wall, which I realize this is kind of insider curatorial stuff, but you might think about this when you're putting things in your own home. It was a really smart way to make a slight psychological difference that allowed these very disparate things, each with their very strong personalities, to work. And here you see wonderful examples of screen printing. It was a particular joy for us to be able, what we had worried about most as one of the most difficult walls has become a lot of our favorite wall. It's been, a kind of interesting trajectory.
So as we move towards the northern side of the gallery, this is the iPad that we mentioned. And if you tap it, you can go through the process. So this is a wonderful teaching tool.
And likewise, there are images of every single one of the prints in the Wadsworth collection, which include not only the ones on view, but the ones that were not, in fact, shown in this, to give you a sense of the rest of the iceberg beneath the tip. And as you move into this part of the gallery, this is, again, we were mentioning, this is a gallery that has four entrances. So we wanted to skew them towards a chronological approach. However, we wanted it to be, something that was intelligible in either way. So if you were to start at this end of the gallery, coming up the north stairs, instead of the south, you encounter more contemporary works. And, it was not a completely unanticipatable, but a kind of not premeditated fact that when you get to this end of the gallery, you're contending with photorealism. At the earlier end of the gallery, you don't see so much of that. But here you have a number of artists who are producing artwork that is informed by photography. So on the far wall, we have a number of works, including two by Noda Tetsuya, probably Japan's, one of his the most famous artists living and working today. These are very quiet, subdued works. And Noda is a really fascinating artist. Like many of the artists here, he started out studying oil painting. But he quickly grew tired of it because he realized in graduate school that the key to success was to produce art that looked like your professor's oil paintings. And he had absolutely no interest in doing that. He felt very pointedly that art should come out of the daily existence of the artist. And he actually literally has done that. His artwork, every single one of his prints is entitled Diary, colon, with a day. And he had been photo documenting his life, and he started to use those autobiographical photographs as the jumping off point for these incredibly thoughtful, quiet, contemplative works of art. And you'll see that what looks from a distance perhaps like a photograph are in fact made using multiple woodblocks, screen printing. At an early stage, he started using mimeograph to reproduce the photograph, to cut multiple blocks in order to be able to produce something that is not quite so literal and photographic, but by the selective way he has enhanced or obscured aspects of the image, becomes so much more eternal. There's an image of apples, three red apples in the Gaston Petit room that are actually, it could reference an earlier work of art from Asian art history, Mucci's famous persimmons, five persimmons. But in fact, those apples are damaged apples because they were the first bites of solid food ever taken by his infant son. And by making those into an icon, those become a very personal memory, but kind of eternal and universal image as well. Likewise here, the original photo that he started with had much more detail, but by obscuring much of that detail and leaving it in shadow, this becomes a real meditation on childhood and parenthood. I mean, it's just, it speaks volumes in a way that I'm sure the original photograph was lovely, but somehow this has become so much more.
Does the date have any significance in this plasma, August 1976, or is it just any day from the diary?
That is the day on which he took the photograph on which this was based. So that is how he goes through his life. He's a fascinating artist because at the time, in this day and age, perhaps this doesn't seem so revolutionary, but in Japan in the mid-1960s, when he first started doing this was outrageous. And he won the first Biennale, the Tokyo Biennale, that he presented artworks, and he did so in a way that was really kind of amazing for the time. Again, in this day and age where everyone blogs and it's not a big deal, he did autobiographical works documenting his own family and the family of his fiance. He's married to an Israeli woman. And he set up images of each of them in the same background with like little bubbles above them saying who they were and what age they were, and presenting personal information in a photorealistic way using multimedia in 1965 in Tokyo was just, it was outrageous. And the fact that he won the prize really set his career in motion. And you know, again, he is one of Japan's preeminent artist, but he is so different. And what you see in this room is so many differences. One of the artists that I'm personally obsessed with is Ida Shoichi, of whom we have two examples. This very mysterious print on the wall, which is again a multimedia work in which he's printed on silk fabric at the top and on what looks almost like photo emulsion paper that he's inscribed. It has screen printing and lithography. He's perforated it. It has stamps. It has hanging textiles. And quite the opposite of that, this amazing double-sided print in the middle of the gallery, which is called Stone, Paper, Stone. The reason that we took the trouble to put this in a double-sided frame is because it is printed on both sides. It is a lithograph. Lithograph means stone print. What is it a print of? It is a print of a stone on one side and a broken lithographic stone on the other side. It is from a series that he did that is about the surface in between. And so he's calling attention to the paper by printing these stones on either side. That stone image shows up in hundreds of his prints. And he did these crazy serialized projects. And in fact, he had a commune in Kyoto. And when we were planning the show, I had conversations with Jeffrey Haynes, our professor of modern Japanese history, who, when he heard we were doing a show of modern and contemporary prints, he said, do you have anything by this artist named Ida Shoichi? And I said, yes! And why? He said, well, you know, when I was really young and I went to Japan, I went and visited a friend in Kyoto and I was looking for a place to stay. And my friend said, you know, there's this crazy artist who lives across the street. You know, I think if you'll help him out with printmaking, he'll let you stay there for free. So Jeff actually stayed for 5 or 6 days in Ida Shoichi's commune and basically paid for his time there by hanging up the prints as Ida was doing his prints, which is, you know, for me, like touching the hand of God. Ida is not around anymore. Short of a seance, I have no way to get to that man. But first person contact with somebody on the campus of the University of Oregon, it's just unbelievable. And you know, because of a show like this, we're able to actually spend the time, money, and human effort to put this in a double-sided frame so that everybody can appreciate Armenia for this particular artist. Yeah. So I don't know if you'd like to talk about Hamanishi as we end.
So I mentioned, you know, a little bit about mini themes within the collection. And one of the themes that, another theme that is, you know, clear, perhaps from the exhibition itself too, is the idea of time, space, and passing of time. For instance, Noda's works are wonderfully poetic vision of how event turns into memory. Mm. And that's why it's so universal, at the same time personal. Now, we will end with the three works by Hamanishi Katsunori, who will be giving kindly giving a talk on Wednesday from 5:30 to 7 p.m. And these are mezzotint. And as Amrose mentioned, mezzotint is this work-intensive process. So to create something of this size is itself amazing. But mezzotint is a technique that is very, very close to and important to the history of Japanese print, because the technique itself was invented in France in 17th century, but it was something that was kind of dying out by the early 20th century. And the people who revived it were the Japanese printmakers who were studying in France in the early part of the 20th century. And Hamanishi is kind of the in that lineage. And you can see these velvety, beautiful black that gets completely lost in digital reproduction. So it's again another print that one would like to see in person. And what Hamanishi is going to be talking about is some of his earlier pieces, but also the newest technique that he is working on, where he is using mezzotint, but also gold foil. So he is, again, engaging with Japan's past, and he will talk about how he does it. So I think it's going to be a wonderfully exciting talk. So if you have the time, please come.
Yes.
And with that.
Yes, thank you so much. We know we have talked for far longer than we should have. But thank you for your attention.
Thank you.